Hello and welcome back. So we'll give you a small introduction to the various packages available for implementing some of the machine learning and deep learning algorithms that you will learn in this course. So to start off with, of course, all of you must be familiar with Python. It's an interpreter-based programming language that is very popular, especially for prototyping and in many cases even for production level software. So it lets you to represent data types. There are several data types, includes numbers, strings, lists, in the form of strings, lists and dictionaries. It has the typical programming constructs like for loops, conditionals and functions, and all variables in general are passed by value. So it has its own scientific computational libraries like NumPy and SciPy, and also plotting capabilities by matplotlib. These are modules that you can import into Python as you program it. Okay, so there are various resources available on the web. One of them is mentioned at the bottom of the page of this slide, and you are welcome to explore these options. So there are again online courses available which lets you learn Python from scratch so that you are more comfortable programming in this language. This is important for many of the other packages that we will see in the subsequent slide. So it's good to have a basic capability in Python. And get it started before we get to the point where we do some programming. So Scikit-learn is another module that comes with, that can be installed in Python. It's a module that comes into Python, and it requires both Python and the modules NumPy and SciPy. Scikit-learn has a lot of the machine learning algorithms already implemented, machine learning and computer vision algorithms available as part of it, which you can just call like a function. So once again, Scikit-learn comes with some excellent manuals and documentation and example code which you should try out. Okay. So this is Python based, so if you know prior programming in Python, you should be able to use Scikit-learn without any difficulty. Okay. Now we move on to some of the deep learning frameworks. So why do we need them? Primarily because it helps you to easily implement and prototype deep learning algorithms. Okay. So in general, you know, coding these algorithms from scratch, even though it's a good exercise, it can distract you from your primary purpose. We expect that most of you are working in some engineering domain where you want to solve a particular problem and not necessarily, you know, solve a programming problem, in this case implementing deep learning from scratch. So there are multitude of solutions available. We've listed some of the more popular ones here. So PyTorch, TensorFlow, Keras. Keras comes on top of as an API on top of TensorFlow. CUDNN is offered by NVIDIA, Cafe and MXNet. Okay, so some of these are offerings from large companies which has freeware, as open source software. So you are welcome to adapt any of them for your course, for your assignments, in order to learn some of the concepts that we will provide in these videos. So if you look at TensorFlow, it's an open source library. It is offered by Google. It's used for setting up data flow graphs. So for any neural network, which you will see in the following weeks, and deep neural networks which you will see in the following weeks, can be set up in the form of a graph. So TensorFlow works in the following fashion. You assemble a graph. You basically define the nodes, computational nodes in the graph, and then you invoke a session to execute the computations in the nodes. Okay. So it's a very nifty tool for implementing deep neural networks. It's also very convenient because a lot of the more popular deep learning algorithms that you see, when I say algorithms, like for instance CNNs or LSTMs, some architecture that works very well, many of the implementations of those architectures are available in through TensorFlow. Okay, so that is free to download, and you can learn to code just by looking at those examples. Once again, Keras is the official high level API for TensorFlow. Again, it greatly reduces the programming complexity involved, because if you start coding even with TensorFlow, even though TensorFlow makes coding easier, especially for implementing some of the deep learning algorithms, Keras provides one more layer on top, so that gives you a very simple way of implementing some of the more popular architectures and more conventional architectures that you see in deep learning. So you will see support for sequential models, so for CNN like convolutional neural network like models and recurrent neural network models. Okay, and it provides you this a functional API wherein you can call functions at different points in the code You can move them around like these Lego bricks. Okay. So, for instance, here is a very simple script for implementing a typical sequential model neural network. You can see that it's accomplished in a very short piece of code. So, some of these terminologies might not be very familiar to you, but what is going on here is that it lets you define some of the computational aspects of some of the neural networks are defined very easily using this model. Okay. So, even if you use Keras, even a very complicated neural deep learning model can be implemented in a very few lines of code, and it is very transparent. So, this is one of the reasons why you would need some of these packages, right. We will move on to the next one, which is PyTorch. Once again, PyTorch and TensorFlow both are very popular among the deep learning community. Both of them offer a lot of features that are very easy, very good for prototyping, and both of them also, in fact, PyTorch also offers a lot of the more popular deep learning architectures already coded with the weights, etc. We will see what these mean later on. Okay. And PyTorch again gives you combined seamlessly with Python. So, if you learn Python, PyTorch becomes very easy. That is another advantage. In terms of capabilities, again PyTorch and TensorFlow are quite similar in terms lets you code some of the deep learning algorithms that you will see in this course. Again, they define variables slightly differently, but other than that, again PyTorch is as good a platform to start with as Google, as TensorFlow again, and PyTorch is provided by Facebook as one of their open source implementations of deep learning algorithms. So, another if you like to work with C++ you like to code that way, then Cafe is the package for you. It's again an open source package from I think Berkeley, and again it's written in C++. It was initially done supported lot of convolutional neural network architecture, but now I think it's branching out into deep learning constructs also. Once again, this is again an open source version. Lot of support in the online community. You can go online, look for, you know, if you want to code something up, how do you do it? There will be some support community there for Cafe, and if you are some person who likes coding in C++, then probably this is the thing for you. Google Colab, again this is not exactly like the package that we talked about, but Google Colab is I would like for you to check it out. It provides you free cloud service. In fact, gives you access to free GPUs and what they call TPUs, tensor processing units, and it also supports PyTorch, TensorFlow, Keras and other open source software packages that you can use for implementing deep learning models. Once again, the attractive aspect of this is the availability of free computing power. So, so from your very low end laptop, you can actually run some slightly sophisticated code. So, if you are programming in Python and want to try a little bit more adventurous, let's say you are using PyTorch or TensorFlow, then this might be a good option for you. Once again, Colab is just the cloud computing architecture and not exactly a package. So, finally, we will come to MATLAB, which is what we will use in this course primarily because MATLAB is providing us with most of the providing the students who are enrolled in this course a free account that you can log into. So, it is MATLAB online. So, you can it provides you the interface which is very similar to the MATLAB desktop, and you can try many of the deep learning and machine learning algorithms that we cover in this course. Okay. Another reason for choosing MATLAB is that we expect a lot of the students who sign up from this course to come from a variety of engineering disciplines, and I am sure most of you are familiar with MATLAB, which is the programming platform of choice for engineering students in general, both in research and in academic and as this well in the classroom. So, we will be using some of the toolboxes in the more recent version of MATLAB, which is 2018B, the computer vision toolbox, there is a statistics and machine learning toolbox as well as a deep learning toolbox. I think the deep learning toolbox was formerly referred to as the neural network toolbox. So, it has been around for some time, but now there is renewed interest. Okay. So, if you are interested in machine vision problems or computer vision problems, there are some handy algorithms already available that you can use. The non-deep learning machine learning algorithms are also available for you to try and test out. They also provide you some data sets which you can load in and play with those. Okay. In addition, the deep learning toolbox offers support for a very easy to use interface for developing convolutional neural network architectures, LSTM and things like that. what appeals to me personally is that they have a very nice module for accessing medical images. So many of the medical images that that are generated are stored in something called a DICOM format, and MATLAB allows you gives you the software routines to read those images into the memory. Okay, so once again, a lot of the post processing that you will do on images, we will see later on in the course, is also available already coded in the form of some functions, easy to call functions, in MATLAB, especially for medical image analysis. Again, image registration, if you are someone who works in image processing, then it has a very nice toolbox for image registration, or toolbox or a set of routines for doing image registration, which again is an integral part of medical image processing. Once again, there are other resources for conventional machine learning algorithms. Okay, they are all listed here. I won't go through all of them, but what you are trying to say is that many of them have a command line interface. Okay, so you can do them from the MATLAB command line, and for this course, you will be given access to an online MATLAB license, and you can try these commands in that browser also. So that's a very convenient thing that MATLAB allows you to do. In addition, they also have the NF tool, which actually provides you with the GUI for creating deep learning algorithms. So we'll look at some of them. So for instance, if you load up NF tool, you will come up with a interface like this, where you can define your deep neural network. So for instance, you can say where the data is. In this case, this is the this is the dialog that lets you load data which you have already stored in some format. Okay, once you load up the data set, then you can divide it into training, testing and validation. So you can give you it automatically tells you how many samples there are and how many do you want in terms of training and testing and validation data. Okay, and then of course you can also use the same dialog box to define neural network architectures, say how many hidden layers, etc. Again, if these terminologies are not familiar to you, you just have to wait another week or so and you will be fine. So we're just walking you through some of the more easier aspects of using MATLAB here. And again, it's very simple to choose the training algorithm, which is again, you are familiar with one by now. Gradient descent is the training algorithm that you have learned right now. So here it gives you some other optimization technique as a training algorithm. On top of that, you can see the performance in the training in the form of graphs. It tells you what the training and testing validation accuracy are. You can define various hyperparameters, monitor them, etc., using the same GUI. Once again, for deep neural networks, what we saw right till so far is the conventional neural network. For deep neural network, again, it lets you access the various layers in the network in the form of just modules that you can drag and drop to create your own. So once you created that, it generates code automatically that you can go and edit. So that is the idea behind using this GUI for creating deep neural networks. Again, I won't go through all the details, but what this GUI shows you is that you can define. So you can define different layers here, and you can examine what each of these layers are on the right hand side toolbox. So it's like drag and drop that allows you that functionality. Okay. So again, a transfer learning, I think we are too far ahead at this point, so I won't really go in detail in this particular slide. But transfer learning is allowed in the sense that you have a lot of the large popular convolutional neural networks and deep neural networks already available as part of MATLAB, which you can reuse in order for your limited data set. So in this course we expect you to use MATLAB primarily because MATLAB is supporting this course. It supports this course by providing all of the registrants access to online MATLAB license, which provides you the interface very similar to a desktop interface. It also provides you 250 megabytes of hard drive data, so you can upload your own data. Of course, not very large data sets, but reasonably large for most of the tasks that you will be doing. And they also provide you support in this, in sense that if you have some trouble accessing, etc., they provide you support for that also. So it takes away a lot of the troubles you might face if you were to figure out an entire platform for yourself. But having said that, we are platform agnostic to some fair degree, and we are okay. In fact, we do personally, we have used many of different software platforms. So we are okay if you want to pursue any of the other packages that you have mentioned, but please note that it is difficult for us to provide support in any form if you have any trouble with the platform itself. Okay, so but MATLAB in this case can provide you limited support if you have trouble with their platform. So that is a possibility. So I hope that we have given you a broad overview of the different options available for you to learn to code. We leave it to you to choose the best option, whatever suits you. Please remember that there is nothing wrong in starting with MATLAB, because it's easy to start that way. Provides you with a lot of the, and especially if you're familiar with MATLAB already, it's okay to start with MATLAB Learn. And it's because many of the programming constructs are similar across the board, so it's not too hard to switch to other platforms in the future if the need arises. Thank you.